kids help.
I was like, we went this year and we hanged out our church, so I didn't know that would help.
Did you?
No, it was very,
yes.
Oh, we did.
Oh,
my.
Oh, that was.
You shouldn't dig it.
Josh.
Wonderful grace of Jesus, greater than all my sin. How shall my tongue describe it? Where shall its praise begin? Taking away my burden, setting my spirit free, for the wonderful grace of Jesus reaches me. Wonderful the matchless grace of Jesus, deeper than the mighty warming sea. Higher than the dark clouds, like a thousand ocean vision, shapes were over me. Broader than the scope of my transgression, greater far than all my sin and shame. Oh, magnify the precious name of Jesus, praise his name. Wonderful grace of Jesus, reaching the most defiled, by his transforming power, making him God's dear child, purchasing peace and heaven for all eternity, and the wonderful grace of Jesus reaches me. Wonderful the matchless grace of Jesus, deeper than the mighty rolling sea. Higher than the mountains, broken like a thousand, all sufficient grace for even me. Broader than the scope of my transgressions, greater far than all my sin and shame. Oh, magnify the precious name of Jesus, praise his name. Wonderful the majesty of Jesus, deeper than the mighty rolling sea. Higher than the mountain, sparkling like a fountain, all sufficient grace for me. Broader than the scope of my transgressions, greater far than all my sin and shame. Oh, magnify the precious name of Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus, wonderful name of Jesus. Magnify his holy name.
Good morning.
Good morning, everybody.
We've got a small crowd today. I know we have a lot of people who are out on fall break, as well as a couple fans. I think two families are sick right now, whole family. So, but welcome to Revive. Let's go ahead and open up with a prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you. We thank you for this day. We just thank you for this time to be able to gather together as believers, as a family, and be able to just bring our praises and worship to you, Lord. We thank you for the ability to be able to come together, to be able to learn, to be able to sit at your feet and to be able to hear your word and study it, Lord. We just pray that you be with us and fill us with the Holy Spirit and help us in all we do today. Father, we ask that you be with those who are not as fortunate as us, those who weren't able to make it today, those who are on our prayer list, and just please continue to help them. Help them with their physical, spiritual, and mental needs, Father. Would you just pray that the Holy Spirit goes to them and tends to them, Lord. Help us also to be an encouragement to those others, that they know that someone else here is thinking of them and that they could see the love of God through us. We ask, Father, that you be with us when we go into this time of praise and worship, that you lead us and help our hearts. We pray, Father, that as we go into our studies today, that you fill us with the Spirit so we could understand the message that's coming to us, Lord. that you just give us the understanding and we're able to apply it to our life and then share that with others. Father, we thank you so much for Jesus, for all that he does for us, for all that he is, the example he set, even with that bar that's set so high, we're just grateful for the opportunity to learn from him. We just pray that we become more like him each day and that we follow his example instead of what's the example of the world. Father, we just ask you guide, protect us, and be with us now, for it's all this. In Jesus Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. Where did Jennifer, is she still back? Oh, we got mini Jennifer. Go to the next slide, please. We'll start with a few announcements. I literally didn't see anybody. If y'all just look, I'm like, somebody back there? Barely see the top of her head. All right, the one announcement, honestly, that we have is our chili cook-off and dessert contest. That's this Friday, folks. This Friday is our chili cook-off, our monthly community dinner. It's the fourth Friday of the month, so we're going to have it this week, 6 o'clock. It goes from 6 to 8. It's our seventh annual chili cook-off, so if you think you have the best chili and you want somebody to try that out, bring it with you, okay? Bring all the sides and fixings. We also have a dessert contest. And it was originally specified for the children, but I think it's for everybody now, right? Yeah. So dessert contest, chili cook-off as well. So that means we're going to have a lot of food. That also means we need to invite a lot of people because we don't want to take all this food home with us, right? So if you would, be sure to invite people. That's the major job. Invite people all over our community, all over the towns nearby. Come and eat. Last year, honestly, it was the biggest dinner we have been able to host yet. We had over 150 people show up for this dinner last year. I pray for another show out like that and let God show his love to all our community. So be sure to invite people for that, please. That's next weekend. This weekend, Friday, 6 o'clock. This weekend, the 27th. That was our only announcement, correct? All right. Anyone have a birthday this past week? Aubrey's birthday. We have Miss Brenda's birthday as well. She's not here. Did neither one of them want to have to come up here?
Brenda had a birthday yesterday.
Yep, Miss Brenda. Anyone else?
Michael Davison had a birthday yesterday.
Michael Davison. Were you saying something, Jennifer? No. All right, we had a lot of birthdays, so let's pray for those who had birthdays this week. Heavenly Father, we come to you again. We just are so grateful for what you do. We're grateful for the life of Brenda and Aubrey and Michael, and we just pray that you put a special blessing upon them. Bless their lives today and the coming days forward. We just pray, Lord, that they keep you as their Lord. Help them, Father, and bless them. Just guide and direct them and help them with every move that they make. We also ask this blessing on those others who had a birthday this past week, who you may have not announced. We just pray a special blessing on them, that you put your hand upon them. For it's all this in Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. How about wedding anniversaries? Anyone have a wedding anniversary or just got married? No? All right, we'll pray for them as well. Lord, again, we come to you in thankfulness. Thank you for the avenue of marriage and of love. We just pray a special blessing on those who had their wedding anniversary or recently got married. We just pray that they put you as their center. We pray that you help them to grow in more love together and, more importantly, grow in their love towards you. Please bless their families, bless their marriages, and keep them all safe. Again, it's in your Son's holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, if you would, let's everyone stand up. We're going to have a smaller group leading us tonight, or this morning, excuse me. So let's go ahead and sing praises to God together.
Friend who walks with me leads me. sinking sand, it is the Christ of Calvary. This would be my prayer, dear Lord, each day, help me do the best I can. For I need thy light to guide me day and night, blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Jesus, hold my hand. I need thee every hour. Through this pilgrim land, protect me by thy saving power. Hear my feeble plea. Oh Lord, look down on me. When I kneel in prayer, I hope to meet you there. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Let me travel in the light divine that I may see the blessed way. Keep thee that I may be holy, thine and sing redemption song someday. I will be a soldier brave and true, and ever firmly take a stand. As I onward go and daily meet the foe, blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Jesus, hold my hand. I need thee every hour. Through this pilgrim land, protect me by thy saving power. Hear my feeble plea. Oh Lord, look down on me. When I kneel in prayer, I hope to meet you there. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. When I kneel in prayer, I hope to meet you there. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand.
Everybody say yee-haw. He's got the whole world in his hand, is not in our book, so it's just going to be up on the board.
In his hands, he's got the whole wide world. In his hands, he's
walking toward that. Next, backslide. Oh, what need? Let's go back. Need we bear? Oh, because we do not care. Everything to God in prayer. Are we weak and heavy laden? Covered with the load of care. You're still our refuge. Take me to the Lord in prayer. Do your friends despise forsake me? The Lord in prayer. In His eyes He'll take and shield. Thou will find a soul instead. Amen. You may be seated this morning. We are low in number, amen? Where two or three are gathered, what does he say? He shall be also. I'm going to pick on you, Jaden. Will you help Callie with the offering, please? Smile. Oh, both of us at the same time. She really does have a beautiful smile. Will you bow your heads this morning? Dear gracious Heavenly Father, we love you and we thank you for the opportunity to be in your house. Lord, we know that we may be few in numbers and have many that are out sick. Lord, we pray that you will just bless each and every one of them and help them to heal. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to take up tithe and offering. Lord, we thank you that you help us to use it in the way that you need it to be. Lord, we pray this morning that everyone will give with a happy heart. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Great, how great.
might be. God, his son's not scary. Send him to die. I scarce can take it in. That on the cross, my burden gladly buried, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings thy soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great backup singers sing when you know you're going to hurt people's ears, right? Will you stand with us again this morning? Amen. I'm confusing her. Probably confusing him back there, too. Jesus does. Holds the orphan, comforts the widow, cries for injustice, feels every sorrow, carries the pain of his children.
Jesus does. So we sing praise to the Father who gave us the Son. Praise to the Spirit that's living in us. When I was a sinner, He saved me from who I was. That's what Jesus does. Who understands? Heart of the sinner showers His grace over all our mistakes, washes us clean with His blood. Jesus does, yes He does. Who sings a song of sweet forgiveness? Who stole the key to hell and the grave? Who has the power to save? Jesus does. So we sing praise to the Father who gave Him the Son. Praise to the Spirit that's living in us. When I was a sinner, save me from who I was.
And when
we're going to have children's minute because we only have 3 children and 2 aren't going to come down here. I know that. Amen?
Amen.
So, we can sing a song still, Callie. Sing a song.
I am a promise. I am a possibility. I am a promise. With a capital P. I am a great big flag of love. Potentiality. And I am mine. If you guys want to smile. I am a promise to see it.
All right, good morning. Good morning. Welcome to Revive, home of the kind and home of the compassionate and home of the whosoever. We are the home of the whosoever. We absolutely believe in Jesus Christ. We believe that he is the only way to salvation and that one day he will be returning again. As always, I'm glad that you're here. Even though you're fewer in number, it is still an encouragement. So thank you for showing up. We do have a very large online gathering. I was back there running the slides for the computer. It's like, oh my goodness, there's a lot of people online. So that's good. I'm glad we are blessed enough to be able to have that ability to be able to not only just get the word out here, but to get the word out to the entire world. Because that's also what we're supposed to be doing. I pray that you receive many blessings from today's message and that the message that is given will encourage you with your walk in life with the Lord. I pray that you take this encouragement and you share it and you live it out. And I want to, before I even jump into here, I just want to first say I apologize if it seems like I'm a little bit tired and worn out, because I am. I'm running on strength of the Lord only. We had my brother's memorial service yesterday, and I had the honor to be able to speak at that, and it's still kind of weighted on us. So please, I apologize if my normal energy is not here today, but I pray the Holy Spirit, he fills me as well as fills you all as well as we go into this word. So with that being said, I need some extra strength. So let's pray together that we all gain this strength through the Holy Spirit. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We just thank you so much for all that you do. We just pray, Father, that you be with us now as we go into this time of study and of thought. We just pray that you help our hearts be open to the message that's given. We pray that you fill not only myself with the Holy Spirit, but with all of us, Lord. Help us to see the message you want. Help us to apply it to our lives and help us to be more like Jesus, Lord. We thank you so much. We love you so much and we give you all the praise and glory now. For it's in Jesus' holy name we ask all this. Amen. Amen. Well, growing up, I remember getting into a lot of arguments with my little brother and also with my friends. And we would tease each other a lot. We would tease each other a lot. We'd make fun of each other. We'd pick on each other. And sometimes we just got mean with each other. I'm sure y'all could relate, especially anyone who has a sibling or has grown up with someone like a sibling. You kind of tease each other. And it's just part of life, isn't it? I remember many times, I would say mean things or somebody else would say mean things to me, and inevitably somebody's feelings got hurt. Somebody usually left in that time in an argument, especially with their feelings on their shoulders, and it hurt more than you intended it to hurt. I remember many times going to my mom on these occasions and I would try to get her involved, and my mom is here in attendance with us today, but I would go to mom and say, "Mom, he's picking on me," or my brother would go to her and say, "He's picking on me," and we would try to get her involved with the issue, and she would hear us out. She would sometimes come to our defense when one of us was truly wrong, but at other times she would just say, "Just brush it off, go on your way, and things will be fine." For some of those times, though, I'd go to mom and that caused my feelings to be hurt, and she would tell me this familiar phrase, Sticks and stones may break your bones, but words will never hurt you. And for most of us, this phrase really stuck, right? Especially the older generation. That phrase, I don't even know where it came from, when it was first started, but that phrase has been out there for a long time. It's been there for my whole life. Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt you. This was something that we would do to help combat those words that honestly that hurt you. Maybe they didn't. Maybe you're just trying to be funny. But it usually helped us to feel like we were able to have some kind of barrier around us, some kind of way to combat the words that were being said to us by saying this phrase. And as a small child, I know I personally used this. This one and another one, I'm rubber, you're glue, whatever bounces off to me, sticks to you, right? Y'all remember that one too. But sticks and stones, man, that stuck around for a long time. But it's not exactly true. We all know that hurtful words will sometimes sting just as much as the physical things that hurt us. Oftentimes, the things that were said to one of us were what seemed to hurt the most. You know, we grew up, all of us had a childhood, and some of us have some scars from the childhood physical hurts that we got. I have several scars. I look at them every now and then. It's like, I remember that one. Or, I don't remember that. Jennifer would ask me, where'd you get that scar? I was like, I don't know. I didn't even know I had that. Or maybe it's just slipped my mind. It's something that's gone through. So we could see the physical scars. But several of us also have those internal scars, those mental scars, those scars that came from possible hurtful words that they're inside. And they sometimes cut deeper than any sticks and stones could ever do. It's these scars that most people will never see or even know about. But they're the very things that could have lasting impressions on people's lives. They could even keep them from being able to be healed from them. While sticks and stones may be used to break some bones, words can also be used to hurt people. Words can be used to damage people on the inside. And honestly, that damage could stay there for their whole life. So we have to be careful with our words, and we have to use them to build people up and not to use them to tear people down. We have to be more like Jesus and use our words to bring glory to God. That's really where we need to be. And for some of us, that's what helps us to draw closer to Him. When we use those words to build others up and we draw closer to God, man, that helps us so much. Because words are powerful if used properly. They could be used to help people find life instead of tearing them down. So in today's message, it's my prayer that we find strength through God's word. It's also my prayer that we could find how we should use God's word in order to bring others to Him. I also pray that we'll be able to see how much power comes through our words and that we need them. We need to use them in the way God intended us to use them. So let's open our Bibles. We're going to be in 1 Peter to start. 1 Peter chapter 3 is where I would like to start today. Fewer people come, fewer page turns, huh? I don't hear as many page turnings today. 1 Peter chapter 3, and I'm going to read 8 through 22, or we will read together. Finally, all of you, have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. Do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, bless. For to this you are called, that you may obtain a blessing. For whoever desires to love life and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Now, who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is good? But even if you suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled, but in your hearts honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you. Yet, do it with gentleness and respect, having a good conscience, so that when you are slandered, those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, than doing evil. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the Spirit, in which he went and proclaimed to the spirits in prison, because they formerly did not obey when God's patience waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is, eight persons, were brought safely through water. Baptism, which corresponds to this, now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience, through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers having been subjected to him. This is going to bring us to our first point for today's lesson, is that we must honor Christ in our hearts and with our lips. And as we open here, we see a great example of how we can honor Christ with our hearts and our lips. The first thing we're asked to do is have a unity in mind. Unity in mind means that we have a unity in mind to help bring others to Christ, that we're working together in order to do the will of God. The next thing there was brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. All these are great examples of what we should be doing daily. These are examples of what Christ did for us, how he treated the people of the world, how he treated people even when he was being done wrong. The next great thing, he says, we're asked to not repay evil with evil or reviling with reviling, but instead we are to bless others when we are given the opportunity to do so. This is hard, isn't it? When somebody does something evil or somebody tries to slander you, what's your first thing? You want to go to your defense, don't you? You want to have your defense mechanism, put your wall up, and get ready for that battle. The Bible here is saying that's opposite of what we should be doing. Do not repay evil with evil, but bless these people. Bless them. By doing this, the Bible tells us that we become more like Christ and we can do more things. Brothers and sisters, this is what we're called to do. If you want to be more like Jesus, if you want to hold that title as Christian, you're called to do these very things. When we do these things, we honor Christ with our actions. And the Bible says when we do this, then we'll obtain a blessing. And this blessing comes from the Lord himself. To me, that's awesome. What greater blessing than from the Lord himself? The blessing we receive when we help others is something that we should cherish, because it helps us to model the actions of Jesus. It helps us to be more like our Christ. And we get closer to him. When we do these things that were listed, we become more like Jesus and we're able to better understand our Savior. We're able to better understand why he did the things he did when we're doing what he's doing. Isn't that what we are called for? The Bible clearly says this is what we're called for. We understand how having a humble heart is beneficial to us, and we can have sympathy for our brothers and sisters, and show them that brotherly love we're supposed to have. When we have this unity in mind, then conflicts will start to become even less. They'll seem like minor things. We'll be able to work together to get through them, even if we don't exactly see eye to eye. We have to work on that unity. This common good should come from doing the work of the Lord and bring others to Christ. We need to come together in the unity of common good so more people start coming to Christ. And I get it. There's a lot of people out. We have several sick. We have several traveling. But there's still no reason this church shouldn't be filled. All the churches that are out there that are speaking the truth about Jesus and doing his work, there's no reason these churches should all not be filled this morning. But several of them out there today are small in numbers. Several are out there today because we're not working in unity and we have too many divisions and we have people who are not doing what was listed here. We can't repay evil for evil. Instead, we need to show others the uncommon love of Jesus. It's what we're called to do. In doing this, we have to do one of the hardest things that there is happening to do in the world, which is keeping our tongue from evil, and we must keep our lips from speaking deceit. It's hard, isn't it? It's hard because your mind says one thing, and sometimes you have to take that tongue and tame it down so those thoughts don't just come out of your mouth. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, though, we must ask Him to help us turn away from the evil and do the good. And in doing good, we must also seek peace and pursue it every day. In our prayers, we should not only honor God, honor Christ with our hearts, but we must also do it with our lips as well. You know my popular saying, don't just talk about it, be about it. Honor Christ in your heart. Honor Him with your language, with your lips, with your speech. This is what is pleasing to the Lord, and it helps us to live a more righteous life. This passage, it also reminds us that while trying to live this righteous way of life, that we may suffer, we may go through trials, but even in that time, we must take hope. It's during these trials that we're probably being watched the most. It's during these times that others may be looking at us to see where our strength comes from. They may be looking at us to see how they're supposed to react to these examples. This is especially true with our children, with our friends that may not go to church anywhere, with our family members who may not go, that they're looking for a place where they could get strength, and they see us because we're a little different. We're a little different. Even in our trials, even with our issues, we still act different than the rest of the world. The Bible is saying this is where it's at. This is where we should get our strength, is through the Spirit. We must honor Christ at all times, because when someone asks you where you get your hope from, then we need to be prepared to answer that question. And when we tell them that our hope is in Jesus, we need to do it out of love and respect and gentleness, because that's how Jesus modeled it for us. He never ran around being arrogant and saying, well, I'm Jesus, so y'all just be like me. No, he did it out of love, respect. He had a tender heart. He was humble. And that's how we need to tell people who Jesus is. He's not the man that's up there judging us, who wants us to follow everything perfectly, who wants us to walk that narrow line and never get off. Yes, he might want that, but he also knows us. He has compassion for us. He has been through what we have been through. So he understands. He understands that we need him. This passage, it reminds us that even Jesus suffered once for our sins. And he did this that so through him we might be able to be brought to God. When we try to show love for others, some are going to show disrespect. Some are going to try to push your buttons. Some are going to even try to slander you for this. Versus like, oh, look at you. They may try to fight back and do everything in their power to tear you down and get you to slip back into your old ways. Anyone else guilty of that sometimes? Even when you try so hard, you have someone that's pushing your buttons and they want you to slip back. But we got to remember this verse. We got to remember this passage. These people, they may even try to get you angry, and they may work you into such a rage that it actually causes you to slip back into that sin. But we need to do our best during these times to still watch the words that are coming out of our mouths. Because sometimes when you're angry, words come out that are sharper than any stick or stone. When we let the Holy Spirit have control of our hearts and our lips, then we could show honor to Christ, and then we could start to help others to heal as well. We could use our words to help heal internal wounds instead of continuing to tear them apart. Because we don't know the battles other people are going through. We might have some guesses on it. They might actually open up and let you know some of what they're battling. But we don't truly know what's in there. Only Jesus does. When we show brotherly and sisterly love to others, though, then they start to wonder where we get that hope and love from. They begin to question how we are so different from the rest of the world, and they are allowed to let us into, that's when we are allowed to enter in a place in their lives, possibly, where they say, hey, I see you've gone through this. I see that you reacted different than all my other friends, and I see you have hope even through all your struggles. Where does that come? That's when we're allowed to talk to them about Jesus. That's when they're finally going to open up and say, tell me more about him. Tell me how he could possibly help me. That's when we give them a taste of the Lord and they could see that he is good. When we are zealous for what is good, then who could really harm us? Honestly, when we're doing God's work and we're so involved in it that we just forget about all the other stuff. It's like, who cares? The Lord is on my side. He'll protect me. When we unite together with other believers, then we can work together to show this love of Christ and then bring others to him. Because that's what it's about, to bring more and more souls to Christ. Then we can see how they can see how we reflect him in our own lives, and then they will want to be more like him as well. This is the unity we should be striving for, not only within our own church, but within our community, within our state, within the world. We should all unite together for Christ to bring more souls to him. But we got to follow these steps. Humble. Gentle-hearted. In unity. When we do this, we could honor Christ with not only our lips, with not only our hearts, but also with our lips by telling others how good God truly is. This time, let's flip over to Ephesians chapter 4, if you would. Ephesians 4. We're going to start in 32 on this one. Yes. 17 through 32. Ephesians 4, 17 through 32. For this I say and testify in the Lord, that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do in the futility of their minds. They are darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God, because of the ignorance that is in them, due to their hardness of heart. They have become callous and have given themselves up to sensuality, greedy to practice every kind of impurity. But that is not the way you learn Christ. Assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in him as the truth is in Jesus, to put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to be put on the new self created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, having put away falsehood, let each of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and give no opportunity to the devil. Let the thief no longer steal, but rather let him labor, doing honest work with his own hands, so that he may have something to share with anyone in need. Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for building up, as it fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. It's going to bring us to the next point for the message, is that we need to speak the truth with our neighbors. The opening of this passage to me is truly sad, because it starts off by telling us that we shouldn't walk in the ways that those who don't have God in their life. The Bible tells us that they're darkened in their understanding and are alienated from the life of God. And this comes from the ignorance of who he truly is. They don't understand God because their hearts have been so callous, they just don't want to hear about it. The Bible says they give themselves over to the evils of the world. And I'm telling you, if you're here today and this doesn't make your heart hurt for these type of people, then it's about time you start listening to the message that's given today. Because these words should hurt us. These words should be what helps us to be driven to go find those people who are like this. Those who have the callous heart. Those who have been hurt so much that they just don't want to hear about it. Those are the ones I personally am drawn to, because I've been there at a time. I've been there in my life at a time where people hurt me so bad and I wanted to take it out on God, but I didn't. I still listened to him. But it took messages. It took people. It took him speaking to me in order to pull me out. We can't be hard of heart like these, because that isn't the way we learn Jesus at all, is it? Jesus was not hard of heart. He was humble. He was kind. He showed grace. We learned that he was tender-hearted, and he showed us a better way to live our lives. We need to put off our old selves. We need to put off our old life and live a better way through Christ alone. That's the only place we can find a better life, is through him. We were all created in his likeness, so when we accept him as our personal Savior, we become an absolute new creature. We become a new creation through him that is way better than anything that this world could ever give us. We need to do our best to live a life of righteousness and holiness in the ways that Jesus showed us to do. The way to live this sort of life is to put away all falsehood and speak truth with our neighbors. And when we do this, then it needs to be done out of love and respect. We're not trying to force anyone into it, because that ain't ever going to work, is it? In verse 26, the Bible tells us that we could be angry. Because I get a lot of people asking me, Pastor, can I be angry? Is it anywhere in the Bible that says I can't be angry? We just read it, black and white. Be angry. But what's the next part? It goes together. Conjunction word there. And do not sin. I think that's what that is. Sorry. English wasn't my best. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger. So, it's okay to be angry, but we need to do our best to not let our anger lead into the next day. We need to do our best to not let that anger get control of us, especially in the heat of the moment, where we say something so sharp, it's going to cut someone deep. The Bible says, don't let the sun go down on your anger. Why? Because it gives the devil an opportunity to get into our thoughts and try to take them over. He'll take that one little step, that one little doubt, that one little bit of disagreement, and he'll try to make it into something way bigger than it ever truly was. I get it. It's hard not to let that anger push you right over the edge. But the Bible here is reminding us, don't let that happen. Don't let that anger get in control of you. Instead, we're supposed to be more like Jesus. And instead of letting corrupting talk come out of our mouth, we use words that can help build each other up, as is for the occasion. I had to put that in because sometimes sarcasm comes out of our mouth, doesn't it? You're like, oh, I want to say something nice. Say something nice over here. That doesn't fit this occasion, so now we're just blowing it up even more. Build someone up as is fit for the occasion. And when we show the grace and mercy that God shows us, we'll be able to see, they'll be able to see Jesus in us. When we show that amazing grace that we just sang about, that God gave to us, we show that grace to others. They're going to know. They're going to know you're someone different, that you are a new creation. We're able to do this when we let the Holy Spirit take over our words and our actions. We need to stop fighting the Holy Spirit because so many of y'all have been doing that. I've had so many of y'all coming to me and said, I know he's been telling me this, but I don't even know how to do it. Or I know he's been telling me this, but that's just not me. That's not who he made me to be. Well, maybe it's time to stop fighting the Holy Spirit, as the Bible tells us, and to start doing what he says. Starting with this part. Don't let the anger get control. Watch your tongue. Hold your speech unless it's to lift somebody up. We need to stop fighting him when he tries to lead us into better things. We need to submit to him, and the Holy Spirit is what I'm talking about here, and let him lead us closer to God in every way that we can. The Holy Spirit is working within you, but you got to stop fighting him. You have to give him the control of your life that he needs. We could do this by being kind to one another. We could do this by being tenderhearted and forgiving one another, and we could do it when we remember that amazing grace that God showed to us, even when we were the wretch, the lost sinner, he showed amazing grace when he sent his son Jesus to die for every one of us. We should do the same thing for others. When we speak the truth to our neighbors about Jesus, who he really is, then we live a life that is reflecting this truth, that we are able to lead others to Christ. We need to do our best to build each other up and stop tearing each other down. There's a lot of it going on. Trust me, although you're not telling me as the pastor hears things. And as Dale says, it told me before, he's their deacon. He's like, some of these things I really don't want to hear. But it's part of our job as leaders of this congregation. That we need to know what's going on. We need to be praying for our brothers and sisters. And we need to try our best to lead them closer to Christ. Because the rest of the world's trying to lead them in the opposite way. The world does its best to tear each one of us down. So we don't see ourselves worthy of God's love. And then it tries to redirect us into us giving into the desires of our flesh. But as the Bible says, that's not how you learn who Christ was. That's not who Jesus was at all. We sang that song this morning. That's what Jesus does. He helps us. Jesus showed us how we all need to do the will of God instead of our own desires. He showed us ways to build each other up and how to show grace, love, and mercy to others. He showed us what true love is by his actions, by the way he treated people with respect, and with a tender heart, even when they weren't doing right. He showed us how we should be speaking to our neighbors every day. Your neighbor is anyone you come into contact with. Because some of y'all are sitting there, it's like, I don't even know my neighbor to this side or in front of me. It's everybody. It's everyone you come into contact. This is how our speech should be. Uplifting. The truth is that everyone needs Jesus so they could find salvation through him alone. And if we're not speaking humble and kind words in our regular speech, they're never going to want to hear about Jesus. They're never going to open up to you. And you're never going to have that opportunity to tell them where your hope comes from. Now let's finish our message by turning to James chapter 3 here. James 3. Starting in verse 1. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. For we all stumble in many ways, and if anyone does not stumble in what he says, he is a perfect man, able also to bridle his whole body. If we put bits into the mouths of horses so that they obey us, we guide their whole bodies as well. Look at the ships also. Though they are so large and are driven by strong winds, they are guided by a very small rudder wherever the will of the pilot directs. So also, the tongue is a small member, yet it boasts of great things. How great a forest is set ablaze by such a small fire. And the tongue is a fire, a world of unrighteousness. The tongue is set among our members, staining the whole body, setting on fire the entire course of life, and set on fire by hell. For every kind of beast and bird of reptile and sea creature can be tamed and has been tamed by mankind. But no human being can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil, full of deadly poison. With it we bless our Lord and Father, and with it we curse people who are made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth come blessing and cursing. My brothers and sisters, these things ought not to be so. Does a spring pour forth from the same opening, both fresh and salt water? Can a fig tree, my brothers, bear olives, or a grapevine produce figs? Neither can a salt pond yield fresh water. This is going to bring us to our final point, which is that we need to do our best to tame the power of our tongue. This point is the one that I really want us to do our best to really drive deep into the hearts, in our hearts, because it really hits home with the themes of today's message. While sticks and stones may break our bones, the tongue is strong. It could hurt and possibly scar people with immense power. As we see from this passage, the first warning we're given is that not many of us should become teachers. And for a lot of you, you're like, great, no problem there, right? But it's telling us those who become teachers, the Bible clearly tells us you're going to be on a stricter judgment. Because why? Because if we're up here, if I'm up here teaching, if I'm in the classroom teaching, I better be living it out. You better be living out what you're teaching and preaching, because God's going to hold you more accountable. If we're up here teaching or in a class or even in your own home teaching about something, God is saying you're held more accountable because you should be doing right first. The Bible tells us that, yes, we all stumble in many ways, but we're also supposed to do our best to be more like Jesus in everything we do. He is the only one who was ever perfect. He was the only one that we're supposed to be like. But the problem is we can't be perfect like him. And that's why we need him in our life. That's why we need him as our Savior to lead us and direct us into a more perfect way. We could do our best, but we will stumble during our journey. The tongue, although small, it's mighty. And this passage reminds us of how it could do big things. Just like a small rudder. I love this example he uses. Just like a small rudder on a big ship, our tongue directs us in our way in life. It can either guide us into good things in life by saying good things and building people up, or it can direct us into the bad things of life and tear people down where we'll go with them. This passage reminds us that a small fire could be set in a great forest. It could set the whole thing on ablaze. So can those simple little words come out of your mouth. Many of us have seen that, haven't we? When we say those few little words that we just had to get off of our mind, and there it goes. The fire is set. And sometimes we can't do anything to stop that fire. The Bible here reminds us of this. The Bible says that these same mouths that bring blessing could bring cursing. But it also says that this should not be so. This should not be how we are. Instead, we need to do our best to tame our mouth, the power of our tongues. We need to be uplifting and encouraging instead of cursing others and tearing them down. We need to use our tongues to bless people and bring blessings. These same tongues that we just sang psalms and praises to the Lord should be the same tongues that give blessings to others. We need to be more like Jesus and use our tongues to honor God. And we need to do His will instead of ours. Sometimes our opinion doesn't have to be said. My mom taught me that. My wife continues to teach me that. Sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes we just need to keep our mouths shut. And the Bible is telling us this as well. Proverbs 18, verse 21 tells us this great truth. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruits. When we're attached to the true vine, that is Jesus, then we will bear His fruits. His fruits bring us kindness, gentleness, love, the great one, self-control. You could go through the fruit of the Spirit, right? That's the fruit that we need to be bearing. When we show the amazing grace to others that Christ has shown, then we could use our tongue to help bring life instead of death. We could use our heart and our tongue to praise and honor Christ, or we could use it for the other. We could use it to bring others to Him, or we could use the power of our tongue to push people even further away. The same tongue that could bring death could also bring life. The same tongue that sings praises to God on Sunday should be the same tongue that we use in the rest of the world come Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. I don't care what day it is. Why can't we go out and sing psalms and praises every day? Why can't we go out and tell the whole world about Jesus and then live like we actually do know Jesus? But sometimes we have a hard time bridling our tongue, don't we? Sometimes our opinions want to come out, even though our mind says, don't say it. So the question I want to ask everyone today is, how are you going to use your tongue? Are you going to use your tongue to cause harm to others, like the sticks and stones? Or are you going to go out and use it to honor Christ starting in your heart and letting it come out through your lips. The choice is yours. If today you found that you need some extra strength in bridling your tongue, and you need the Lord to give you that strength because you know you're too weak to do it yourself, then I ask you to come. For those who can't come, just stay in your seat and bow your head and ask God for that strength. Maybe some of y'all today need some extra help in learning how to uplift people because it's just not natural. We get it. Then come and ask God to help you be more like Christ. Help you, help use the prayer to gain wisdom from Him. He told us we each stumble in our own ways, and that's why we need Jesus. So if you need anything at all, I ask you today to come. These altars are open.
Temptation comes my way. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much. We thank you for your words that are uplifting and that give us life, Lord. We just pray that the message we heard today sticks deep in our heart, that it helps to heal wounds, that it just helps us on the right path today moving forward. Help us also to share this message with others who may be struggling, who need your son even more than we do, Lord. Help us when we stumble. Please forgive us when we do wrong, Lord. And help us forgive those who did wrong against us as well. Help us to be more like Jesus each and every day in our walk in life, Lord. And help us to stop fighting the Holy Spirit. Place your spirit deep within us, Lord, so we could be more like your son. So we could enjoy that day when we get to see you face to face. Father, I ask also a special prayer on our community, on our state, on our nation, and especially this world right now, Father. We ask that you have your hand upon us all. Give us safety. Give us peace. Give us strength that we need and the wisdom to fight off the evils in this world. Protect each one of us as we go our ways today. Guide us in the path that you want us to go. Lord, we love you. We thank you so much for Jesus, the great example he set. Father, it's all this in his name and power and authority we ask. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. All right, tonight we've already decided that as the board that we're not going to have evening service tonight, so no evening service. I will put that on social media because we do have a few that come from our neighborhood, but no evening service tonight, but we will meet again on Wednesday night, 7 p.m. We have classes for all ages, so if y'all would, that's the next time we can meet. I pray y'all have a blessed day and that everyone goes out and tells somebody about Jesus.